culture, king to king. King to king. Yeah. King to king. Do you know what it means to king to king? King to king. Yeah. King to king. Then to your neighbor and say king to king. King to king. Two young people entered into an argument. And then, this was a smart young lady, done with college, had a very good job. And they were dating. And I admired what they did because they were really doing it the Christian way. They came to church together, they never stayed late in the darkness, they never did funny things. And I thought they were meant to be the best of all couples of the time. And so one time they approached me and the lady began to complain and said, "Pastor, I am seriously through. I am true with you." Then he said, "Why?" The statement she made is the one that has given us the title this evening. She said, "Pastor, he doesn't want to be the king." I thought I knew a lot of dragons, but this one flattened me. He doesn't want to do the thing. And you know, pastors, sometimes we want to be smart. You know, the unknown type that I was again. Then I came to the guy, hey, my friend, he said, "Why don't you want to do the thing?" Then he said to me, "Pastor, honestly speaking, I am lost. Why are you lost? I thought you came here together." "Yes, Pastor, you did. But I don't know what she means by doing the thing." Then I said, "My sister, this fiancé of yours does not know English. Can you please tell him what it actually means to do the thing?" "Pastor, we've been dating for 4.5 years. I'm a virgin. I have a job. I don't need his money. I just need a permanent relationship. I want to have my own home. Why can't we do it too?" So I put the pieces together and said, "Brother, this is a very simple English discussion. Don't create your faith." This lady says, "You've been doing good. You've been doing a thing. The first time around, she wants you to do the thing. Paying chocolate is doing a thing. Walking around and gallivanting is doing a thing. Sending text messages and making each other happy is doing a thing. What to do is getting married. This lady says she is ready to replace King the Doom." Then he said, "I am a pastor. No, I understand." And the lady said, "Wake up, boy. The sermon is entitled this evening, Do the Doom. Now I want to know, read a text and ask you a question. John chapter 14. John chapter 14. Probably we can read it from the screen. John chapter 14. Okay. And we read that verses 15, 23 to 24. John chapter 14. Verse 14 says here, chapter 8, in John chapter 14, look now at verse 15. Verse 15. Okay. If you love me, you will do the do. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. Let's jump to 23 and 24. It says here, Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, if anyone, Jesus answered and said unto him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Verse 24, please. He who does not love me does not keep my words, and the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. In this text, Jesus is trying to explain what it means to love God and what it means not to love God. In this do-the-do of the young couple, this lady just wanted a proof from this gentleman. You've been saying that you love me. In fact, you've been calling me funny without testing anything. You've been calling me speaking without making anything. Now I want you to do the do. Marry me if you love me. Now in that statement, the lady was also saying, if you do not love me, do not marry me. Are you together? Amen. If you do not love me, do not marry me. But if you love me, then marry me. Jesus is saying here, if we love God, then we will keep his commandments. If we do not love him, we will not keep. Simply stated, those who love Jesus are not identified by lip services that they produce, but by actually loving him, by keeping his commandments. And he's also saying by this statement, if you want to know somebody who hates God, you'll know it just by the breaking of the laws on your part. If they do not keep his laws, it means they do not love him. If they keep his laws, it means they love him. Let's go to the book of John. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. John chapter 10. Luke chapter 10, verses 25 to 26. The Bible says in verse 25, and behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, Jesus, saying, Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Verse 26, he said to him, what is written in the law? What is your reading of it? Verse 27, he answered and said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Verse 28, Jesus answered him, you have answered rightly. Do this, and you will live. So if we do the word of God, if we follow the word of God, if we obey him because we love him, then we will live. Now Jesus asked this liar who came to him, what do you think is the law of God? The gentleman said, love God with all your heart, and you call your name and you call it your heart and love your neighbor as yourself. And then you Christians that are knowledgeable about scripture will begin asking, but Pastor, this is not the law of God. I mean, it is not the Ten Commandments. How comes that Jesus also accepted this as a person as the Ten Commandments? I mean, this is not the law of God. Love God and love your neighbor as yourself. Full stop. Well, the good news is, the Ten Commandments is summarized into two. Otherwise, the Ten Commandments has two chambers. The first chamber teaches us what we should do in order to relate well with our God. The second chamber teaches us what we should do to relate well with our fellow neighbors. I want to tell you. So I'm going to say amen to this letter. I mean, the man was a learned man. And so he says, I know the law. You love God and you love your neighbor. And Jesus said, yes, you have done well. Let's go to the book of Exodus, chapter 20. I went up to now define what it means to live well with your neighbor. Come together. And this I'm reading from the Ten Commandments of God. Exodus chapter 20. We are beginning with verse 17, where we find none of the ways. It says, you shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, nor his maidservant, nor his civil servant, nor the ox, his cows, his house, and everything that your neighbor has. Do not covet. I'm not saying that do not, or the scripture is not saying, do not yearn or desire to be like him or her. Are you together? But this simply means do not try to take what your neighbor has. Read together. If my neighbor is HOD, right? Head of department, and a mess. And then I try to do everything possible so that I will become the head of that department. Department. That is perfect justice. Are we together? If my neighbor scores a GPA of 4.0, and I look at him and I say, Pastor Jeremiah, hey, I want to be like this guy. And I go to him, please can you help me so that I can be, I can also have at least 3.7, please help me. And he shows me how to make a 4.0 GPA. That is a desire, which is good. But if I have to say two things about Pastor Jeremiah, so that the lecturer will mark every good point wrong, so that I will overtake his position, that is the righteousness. Come together. Do you think that this law of God is good so that we can have a good relationship with our neighbors? Do you think so? You think it is right, isn't it? Well, this is the 10th commandment of God. This is commandment number 10 of the 10 that he has given us. Let's go up. The 9th one, number 16 says, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. Do you think it is still great? Talk to me, church. Is this still great?
You will be happy if your neighbor makes a false statement or false claim against you. No, you wouldn't. The king once says, you shall not steal. And what will ask you? The second one says, you shall not commit adultery. Then what may ask you? If you love your neighbor, would you go for your neighbor's wife? You do that. So you think this law is still coming, isn't it? Because if you love your neighbor, you will not go for the wife nor the husband. Jesus is saying, it is true that you love God with all your heart and you love your neighbor as yourself. So the scripture is very clear here. If you do not commit adultery, it means you have obeyed God's commandment. And surrender, you put God's commandment, you and your neighbor will have no issues. Are we together, church? Can we have no issues? The sixth one says, you shall not murder. You think if you love your neighbor, you will kill him or her? No. And surrender, you do not kill your neighbor, you will be having a good relationship with people around you. So far, these six of the ten items in the Ten Commandments describe how we can have a perfect relationship with our neighbors. And so, if you think these commandments of God are good and they are good, just wave at me and say, hallelujah. Wonderful. Now, in the few minutes that we have, I want us to also talk about the sign of the commandment. Remember, so far, we have just been dealing with the commandment that deals with how we can have a good relationship with our neighbors. And we have all agreed that these are signs and we must keep them. Now let's begin from commandment number one. Exodus chapter 20 and verse 3. The Bible says, you shall have no other gods before me. And before this, we give a preamble in verse 2. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Okay? Because I am your God. And to all of us, because God is our person, because He is our Redeemer, because He is our God, we must have no other gods before Him. Commandment number one. Commandment number two, you shall not make for yourself a cow to the demon, any likeness of anything that is in heaven, a child or a beast in the dark, the earth, or what is in the water under the earth. You shall not come down to them nor serve them, for I am the Lord, I am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generations, a curse to the wicked, but showing mercy to thousands, to those who love me and keep my commandments. Do you think that if we love God, we will have another God beside Him? But do you? We will have another God apart from God. Even we, human beings, when we are in a relationship with others, by the way, what you did not know about me is that I am as jealous as God is. Except that God's jealousness is protected with wisdom and divine understanding. I can be foolish sometimes. I don't check on my wife. But if you call my wife, but I'm all the time when she must be sleeping, I will take offense. I mean, you can't call my wife at 11 p.m. What's wrong with your head? No, I mean, I want to say I am jealous because God is also jealous. If you are my wife's boss and you would want to push her around and
and search her and describe her as my nanti, I will make her straight at him. No, because I'm a jealous God. And so if I am being a human being, I can even be a jealous and I wouldn't want to share my dear life with someone else. What about God? And so we are going by saying that God does not want us to share His glory with any other thing a human being. Put it together. This is why, if God says, do not wear a miniskirt, your body is actually my temple. Do not wear a miniskirt, and you choose a miniskirt, the Lord of God, you have made an idol for yourself. Don't say amen. To see anything that you love more than the Word of God has become an idol. Are you together? No, as for me, this one, yeah, I know it is true that anything that you have a bat, that bat will bat you. You know that? If you add a bat to any word of God, that is going to bat you away from the kingdom of God. So be careful about that. He says he is a jealous God. And so long as we do not make the God any other God beside Him, we will have a good relationship with God. Pray together. Alright. Yes. It says, you shall not make the name of the Lord your God. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. For the Lord will not grant him guiltless who takes his name in vain. I have a problem with people who play this way. Let me forgive me. This is where I'm relaxing. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you this evening. Oh Lord Jesus, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Oh Jesus, you see, oh Father, Jesus, we thank you. For you have said, oh Jesus, for you have said, oh Jesus, you know that, oh Jesus. For every three words you produce, there is the name of God somewhere there. This is my way of taking the name of God in vain. The others are like swearing on God. I mean, swearing by the name of God. And you know that what you are saying is false. But for others to believe you, you say, I swear in His name. You are taking God's name in vain. But I think, one of the things that people need to learn from me is that my wife does not like it when you call me by my first name. When she's around, do not say Paul. I mean, that is being too close to me. Well, what my wife does not accept, which is a fact, is that in the English culture, when you are calling someone by the first name, honey, you don't use a title. So anyone here can say Paul. But you cannot address me Naruto. Now this goes my fellow challengers who are calling people by their surnames without having a title. In the English culture, you must say Mr. Naruto. You say Paul without a title. But you cannot say Naruto without a title. Are we together? Because I mean, that's my surname. But it's Naka. Yeah, the English scholars are here, and they will tell you. So my wife does not want people to just call my name anyhow. What about God? Now, there is a crucial point here that I want us to make, and it is in the fourth commandment. In the fourth item. Verse 8. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath day of the Lord your God. So all the name that I have read, all Christians
across the world, a dream that we must keep them. How many of you have a problem with any of the money apart from the Sabbath? Look at your head. You don't. How many of you think that all the nine commandments, loving God, not calling his name in vain, not having any other gods, and relating very well to our brothers and sisters, how many of you think that those commandments are good? None doesn't. But some Christians have a problem when it comes to keeping the Sabbath day holy. They give excuses. And so you see, because Jesus resurrected on Sunday, he gives us to keep the Sunday. Well, if Jesus changed the Sabbath from Saturday, which is the seventh day of the week, to the first day of the week, which is Sunday, it would have been recorded in the Bible. And in fact, these disciples wouldn't have kept it. Luke chapter 23, verse 56. Luke chapter 23, verse 56. Look. The Bible says, and they returned and prepared spices and fragrant olives, and they listed on the Sabbath according to the commandment. Now, this test is a follow-up of what the disciples of Jesus and the friends did. Jesus had been killed. It was a Friday, the Bible says it was the preparation day. And the disciples followed Jesus. They went only another woman. They went into the burial place and saw him buried. He was laid in that tomb. But now they went home, they went to prepare spices so that they can come and prepare the body of Jesus Christ as custom demands. But after they had known that, they realized that the Sabbath was approaching. How many of you here know the day on which Jesus Christ was crucified? Is it Friday or Thursday? Talk to me, Friday or Thursday? And so, if the Sabbath was approaching, which day is the Sabbath? It's Saturday, isn't it? But God bless you. I want you to go home with these thoughts. And tomorrow, as we do chapter 2 of this sermon, when we shall identify which day is the Sabbath, and we will be asking you some serious questions. Is this still valid? Should we keep the Sabbath day holy? In fact, I intentionally wanted to take this sermon to teach this topic because many of us have admitted as students into this institution, according to the student's handbook, we must keep the Holy Ghost, I mean, the Holy Sabbath. We must keep it. Whether you are Catholic or an Anglican, wherever you come from, you keep the Sabbath day holy, including Hindus and Buddhists and Christians. All of us on Sabbath, we can be here and worship God. If you do not have a proof from God that the Sabbath is holy, and it is the word of God, do not pray to do. If it is proven from the word of God, as we shall see from tomorrow evening, and do the truth, and then keep it free. Father, desire will bless the name this evening and give it glory and honor. You have said that if you love you, you must keep your commandments. And one of the commandments says,
but you must keep the Sabbath day holy. This commandment has confused many. This commandment has surprised many, but we pray that he may give us an understanding. Yes, it is brothers and sisters of mine, bring them back to God.